what is cereulide actually? It's a toxin found in some starchy foods, especially when they are being reheated, and it is synthesized by B. cereus, and it's very common causative agent for food poisoning cases in Hong Kong. And this cereulide would cause people to vomit and have diarrhea and all sorts of food poisoning symptoms. And this kind of B. cereus poisoning is generally known as fried rice syndrome. And this term is increasing, has a spike of attention in recent years. So what exactly we can see in our daily life? So what kind of cases are there? So there will be some Instagram poses. For example, this one is about a pair of a couple having some heated fried rice, and then they have multiple organ failure and have different kinds of one is unfortunately dead and the other one has life danger just by eating fried rice. Can you imagine that? And also for this one is a large group food poisoning and it's very unfavorable, and although it's spaghetti, but it actually it can cause a lot of different kinds of food poisoning symptoms, which is unfavorable for especially the vulnerable group. And for the 2022, there's a case by food and the food safety focus, and it's B. cereus in fried rice, and it's reported in the Center for Food Safety. And it is actually related to this case in June 1 that the B. cereus has like 11 times more than it is allowed, and this would have the cereulide in it, and it would even cause different the liver failure if the cereulide content is too high for people to handle. And yeah, although people have a low awareness of cereulide poisoning, as seen from our survey we have done, so, but actually the cases are all around us, just small cases, but they are actually all around the world and it's around us. So, as seen from the case, pasteurized rice and pre-cooked food are of high risk. And why cereulide cannot be destroyed by heat, and also it is not destroyed by acid, that's why it's difficult to degrade. And even if people often think that if we reheat the food, and then it's safe to eat because there's no bacteria in it, but actually it's not, because cereulide is still in there. And that's why the people eating those pre-cooked fried rice may have these kind of food poisoning symptoms after consuming the food. And these would be the consequences of eating cereulide contaminated food. So the most common one would be vomiting, diarrhea, nausea, and the more dangerous ones would be liver failure or even death. So since it's very difficult to destroy cereulide, we would have a solution, which is cereulide, our test kit, to have on-site lab-on-chip the test for cereulide, such that the firms don't need to send the samples to the lab to detect whether there's cereulide or B. cereus in it. So it will be much quicker and also accessible for the untrained users, and also the test kit can be stored for a long time under different conditions, so it would be much more convenient and easy to use and effective in preventing any more cereulide poisoning cases, which is totally preventable actually, with more careful handling. As for our outreaching, we first try to understand what are the potentials of our test kit by reaching out to a Chinese food restaurant yesterday, which is Les Yongcha. And Sun Sifu kindly shared with us his experience in preparing different dim sums or steamed rice in his restaurant, and helped us to know that he is actually positive about having test kit in the on site to detect whether the food is safe there. And we also reached out to C Mart, an online retailer for the food box, and Mr. Lam also shared with us his insights and also procedures in preparing the food boxes. And for professors, we also find Professor Sid and Professor Puig to give us some advice on the development of our test kit. And we also reach out to different iGEM teams, for example, UM Macau and also Wuhan, and also different teams in Hong Kong. So After that, we also try to promote our idea and also do some education on cereulide poisoning since the awareness is not very high. So we do weekly stories on our Instagram. So feel free to read our Simbao news each Sunday, Synthetic Sunday. And also for our food safety, we have done some surveys and we will continue to roll out more of them to get more insights from the general public. And for secondary school students, we also provide some Simbao workshops for them. And we also volunteered in Food Angel to know more about the food processing procedures. And also for Professor Yu, we also try to inform the campus about the potentials of cereulide poisoning that can be like dangerous to the students and also the staff on campus. So that's all for IHP, and let me pass the time to Agnes. To talk about our circuit design.
So for our circuit design, we have found out that cereulide would cause an efflux of potassium in the subtlets, which can be detected by a series of kinase which will produce phosphorylated SbO0A, which can be used to activate our circuit. And for our circuit, our target is to have a red signal when there is cereulide and a green signal when there is no cereulide. And this is our circuit design where GFP will be constitutively produced unless when there is cereulide and RFP will be produced and GFP will stop production and be degraded. And next we'll talk a bit more about our circuit design driver part.
So hello, I'm Agnes, and actually there are a few things we need to model, as we just mentioned. The first one is that caused the potassium efflux, we need to find out the relationship, and potassium efflux to conservation, and then lastly to our circuit modeling. So here is the result of different concentration of frozen protein after we model that some of the assumption. So you can see that firstly the GFP is when cereulide is present, GFP is constitutively produced at first. And you can see a turning point that GFP start to be degraded and also being repressed not to produce. And then you can see at around 48 minutes then GFP will be totally degraded. And then we can solve the mixing issue, but then it's still too long. So one of our aim is to shorten the reset time. So when cereulide is absent, then it should be mostly GFP. Now I'll pass the time to Jason to talk about the weather.
So for weather, we have a few experiments. First of all, is biofilm formation caused by cereulide, and we will add different concentration of cereulide into our feed samples and see how long it will take for it to form biofilm. And we are expected to see early biofilm formation in feed samples when cereulide is present, and also we will try to use myosin, which is quite similar to cereulide, and see the effect towards feed samples. And for our second experiment, it will be potassium efflux assay. Because as mentioned earlier, we have found out that cereulide will cause potassium ion efflux from B subtle cell, and we'll try to quantify the magnitude of potassium efflux, and we are expected to see some fluorescent signals which can indicate the influx of potassium.
So I'll talk about this part. This part is actually the collaboration of different modules in our team. So we are aiming to build a degradation tag library. So as we mentioned before, our circuit actually of the degradation tag system. So our main goal is to provide more choice for conditional degradation by knowing the performance and also the classification of whether they are adaptive dependent, stable or unstable. So for dry lab, we have actually two approach. The first first approach is bioinformatics. We are going to analyze the current data with PSSM to see how frequently amino acid is exists in different groups of text. And the second part, as we want to study the interaction of the SSRI tag of and to the protein, so we are also doing the 3D protein modeling. We are using PIMO to see the interaction of how the tag are binding inside. After that, we would find some potential tag from the dry lab part and to pass to the wet lab to do the experiment with, and to prove whether they are in SSPV dependent, and we can use that for conditional degradation. So I will talk more about the dry lab part. So other than modeling and collaboration, we also have we're also interested about how the cereulide is distributed in rice, and also we are going to help hardware to build some apps and modeling. So for first part, actually we want to model how cereulide is going to distribute in our sample, which is rice, and also provide insight for us to know which part of the sample is representable, so that we can take that part for our hardware test kit. So actually, the cereulide can be come from soil or atmosphere. So the first part will be spore modeling. So we are just using the random simulation of the spore and generate their initial population. And then the second part is to model of the bacteria from atmosphere. So how are we going to do that? We are actually doing experiment to collect more data and then pass it to our image processing code, and then we turn it into matrix and then put it into a 3D visualization. So here is our GUI. We make it to visualize how the rice is going to distribute in rice. Now I will pass back the time to Noel to talk more about hardware.
Sure. So for our hardware, it would be like using allowing the end users, which are the restaurants and also the food suppliers, the organizations who provide the meals in big batches, so that they can conduct this test on their own and know that whether the rice is safe rapidly. So for our biosensor, we will be using B. subtilis spores with the reporting system with RFP, GFP, and the transport minute, and then we would embed them into gel, which is a PVA gel, hydrogel, to suspend them. After that, we can apply the sample and then observe the results after some time when the RFP or GFP is expressed. And for the analysis of the results, we can use our mobile app to take a picture of the gel result and to test whether the concentration of cereulide is high or exactly how much cereulide it is. So for the sampling, we would basically use some physical methods and then grind it and also put it into a buffer to prepare the sample, just like the COVID-19 test kit, easy and simple. And for the gel analysis, we would provide a small box which can enhance the imaging effect and also can see the fluorescence more effectively and accurately. So for the gel, we would use biocompatible one, and also we hope to extend shelf life by encapsulating it and also using the spores so that the results can be seen after adding in the sample, and also because it's suspended in the gel, so the users will not be exposed to our GMO bacteria, which can enhance biosafety. And yeah, let me pass the time to Agnes.
So compared to dry lab part, we are going to help hardware to do a mobile application. As I just mentioned before, we actually have color missing issues. So for customer, it might be very difficult to interpret the results. So we are using AI algorithm to do the image classification and help interpret the result. So, and then we also integrate the system into the apps so that the user can use it. And our app is also also have the educational effect. So the user can use our app to learn more about synthetic biology and also our project. So this is our presentation. Thank you.
Training models specifically for each phone, and if you are, like, what's the training time? But if you're not, like, if it's a single AI model, what's the accuracy? What's the margin of error here?
Thank you for your question. This is actually a question we also need to look into. So for our idea just now is actually by doing experiment, we collect the photo data, and then we will pass it into the platform that train the AI. And then later on, we just integrate with them. But then that is a good question. We will look more into that. Thank you.
Just a short question here. I want to ask, how long does the score last? Was that in the PBA gel?
From our paper, it can last from 1 year to 3 years when it's dried. So the PVA gel can actually be dried during transportation, and then we have it with LED mediums after when the users are ready to use them.
Okay, so you guys will, if you guys are going to produce a kit, then you will like provide LED medium along with the kit, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, we can see that our PX is GPS 14.4 minutes. But then actually, that doesn't mean that we can see the result because we don't know whether it is dense enough for us to see the result. So this is also one of the things we need to go through when we are doing the actual experiment. And also, we need to work with hardware because the gel diameter could also affect how when the time for us to see the result. So we are actually still working on that. Checking with him.
And when the test kit is used, it would be like germinated cells.
So like
for
the germinated cells. Also have to wait for the cells to.
Yeah. We would need to prepare the gel, reactivate it, and start using it. So because we are trying to balance between the storage time and also the user compatibility. So yeah, we are still looking into which is the best, and we will optimize along our wet lab and hardware.
And then this is the end of our presentation. Thank you.